Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, just thank you for each and one of us being here at your house, Lord. And we just let us listen to the word that you bring through Brother Gary, Lord, and take to our hearts, Father. And be with the people that are not able to be in churches today, Lord, that they may have their ears and eyes on something that they see you today, Father. And we just thank you, Lord, and just be with each and one of us through this day and guide our hearts, Lord. And we just love you so much for always listening to our cries and our worries and our issues in our life, Father. And you just knowing that you listen to us, that we just it just brings our heart to just a point in life that we just can always count on you on everything through our hard times. And we just love you and all this in your precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, church family. We're going to start this morning in our worship and praise, singing Same God, and then the second one would be Come As You Are. Same God first, please.
Whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean. I need you now to do the same thing.
You are the same God. You are a Savior.
Decorated some. I didn't want to block their view. So, good to be here. Fixing upset my wife, but I'm gonna have to have you come up here for a minute.
Michelle.
Come on, you look like a spotlighted deer back there. I don't brag on her enough, and I think this is about the second, third time I've did this, about 8 years. And I'm gonna catch it in the car, but I'll just reach over and be like, but I just want to say, you know, the people I've been around, she has one of the biggest servants' heart of anybody I've ever seen. And the church don't see half of it, you know, so just want to thank her and for putting up with me, because I can't be a handful.
Amen.
Amen.
I'll let you know later on if she gets upset what she says out of the car. Word for word.
You walk out the back saying that wasn't necessary.
I'll be, it'd be a sermon than the talk in the car. But anyway, just to be honest with you this morning, you know, last 2 or 3 days, you know, I'm like, well, all right, Lord, you're going to give me something to get everybody in the Christmas spirit and this and that. And, you know, I even showed Brother Allen my lesson this morning was about rejoicing in all things. And of course, sometimes Lord gives you a message that's pretty tough to bring, but you have to bring it anyway, you know, instead of going over what you want to. But next week, I'm 98% sure. Next week, you know, we kind of going to get ready for the Christmas. And it's a message kind of that says, from the crib to the cross to the crown. And that's what baby Jesus is all about. You know, it's not about the gifts and the trees and the shopping and all that. And I hope we don't lose focus that Jesus is the real reason. But you know, it's been a lot of things go on, a lot of things happen. Some stuff happened this past week just literally blew my mind on the national world stage and just things you know, you hear and you talk to people about. And, you know, we need to be getting ready for that day. We need to be preparing. It's kind of funny, this morning, Sunday school class, we was teaching about pressing toward the goal. We should be pressing and pushing for maturity, spiritual maturity. And so many times we just sat back and just put on cruise control. Well, guess what? Christianity is not an entitlement, get something for free and do nothing. It's just not that way. And seen a really good speaker the other day, and I started watching this guy, and I'll be honest with you, when I first seen him, I kind of like, I don't know about this, but anyway, the Lord led me to listen to it, and awesome. And you know, we in the church, just to put it straight up, you don't need to be telling people they're going to hell. You ain't going to spend time talking to them. Because back in the day, you know, I was brought up in church. Been around church my whole life, but I got news for you. There was a time a Bible thumper come up and tell me that. I make him think he was going there. So, you know, we got to learn to love people. But here's the gospel. If you're a drug addict, we're to respond, Jesus loves you and want a relationship with you. If you're gay or homosexual lifestyle, guess what? Jesus loves you and want a relationship with you. That's what got us there. An amazing thing about that is, too, you know, we accept that. You know, once we accept God's free gift, once we make that choice, and this guy said it, and I shared it with the class this morning. Then for some, there's a little bit of bad news that goes along with it. See, once you accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, and if I was to ask everybody here now, have you accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior, you're going to go, yes, 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 yes. It might be some, one or two, and I hope that changes the day. Might say, well, I've never been saved. Well, I hope you get saved today. But if you've accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, then you died with Him. Your will, your thoughts, your desires, your way of doing things, It died with him, and your will becomes his will. Because he bought and paid for you at a cost. So our life gets wrapped up in doing his will. And at the end, it's good news anyway. So that's what it all means. So today, you know, we're going to kind of look at some stuff. There's been some stuff going around. And you know, and what kind of stirred me a little bit, I had somebody tell me the other day, said, man, I just really love your church and love the way you preach. You talk about hell a lot. That scares me. Well, if it scares you, you might want to meet Jesus. Because if you're truly saved, you should not fear hell. You should not fear going there. And guess what? That's the other side of the coin. To me, if you don't preach heaven and hell, how do we know we need to go to the doctor unless we're sick? There's two sides to everything. That's the reason the gospel. That's the reason God sent his son to save man and humanity from that. So that's part of it. But not all people's going to heaven. The Bible says so. Here's another thing. You cannot work your way into heaven. So you can do all the good works, do all the stuff. Guess what? Without Jesus, you're not going. This is not going to happen. And there's a common thing going around, you know, all people's going to go to heaven. And you know, you work, and all this stuff. It's not none of that. Your salvation's there. Guess what? You can't lose your salvation. Some people say you can, but here's my thing. All right, I accepted Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. It says that the Holy Spirit comes and lives inside of me. You think God's going to take that back out? I don't think so, because if you're truly saved, you ain't ever going to lose it. So if I did lose it, guess what? I won't have to go back and say the same thing again. What about the person who does that 10 times? He really don't believe what's going on anyway, right? So once you're truly saved and the Holy Spirit comes living inside you, guess what? You're sealed with that Holy Spirit. It's there. Mm-hmm. Now, you can quench that Holy Spirit and grieve that Holy Spirit. You don't even hear God. You have no conviction. Your heart's hard. And, you know, God, Jesus is the judge of that. And he's the only judge. See, we're not perfect enough to look at anybody and tell them they're going to hell. Only Jesus is going to do that. See what I'm saying? So we got to get our stuff on the same page. You know, I've talked to a couple about church. You know what? I'm going to be 100% real with you. I miss church some on Sunday, but I got a good reason to not go to church. Whether it's going to see my daughter, going to see somebody sick, maybe every once in a while me and Michelle take a vacation. But I'm doing my Bible study. I'm doing my church just like if I was here. Guess what? God tells us to come together. So we can help each other grow. And it's about spiritual maturity. We was talking about pressing toward goals, pressing toward spiritual maturity. And if you are a true Christian, your number one goal is to be more like Jesus every day. Now, we're not citizenship. We're not citizens of this world. Our citizenship is in heaven, where we put all of our focus, all of our energies in that. We don't even belong to this, but too many in church house, guess what? Live for pleasures, run with the world, and they're easy to see. They're easy to see. I know some, and it's not my job to call them out. It's my job to preach the word and let God convict them if God can convict them. Charles Spurgeon once said, "The scripture does not say you must be improved. But it does say you must be born again." See, religion will make you a better person to do good things and all this. But to be reborn spiritually means that the Holy Spirit of God comes into your body, seals it up, and there you go. You have been spiritually reborn. It's a drastic change in the whole outlook of life. Your ways change, your moods change, just everything changes. It don't happen instantly like me and Brother Allen's talking about. It don't happen instantly. It takes time. But guess what? We're supposed to want to mature. I know some of these girls, matter of fact, Faith and them was here, I guess it's back during the summer or something, you know, and they come in like a typical fifth, sixth graders, and then all of a sudden they started dressing up and putting on. I was like, good grief, these girls have grown up. They want to grow up. Boys want to grow up. A Christian should want to mature, to grow, to be more like Jesus. But do we? Is that one of our main focuses? Get this. You think church, coming to church, is going to save you? Nope. You got a better chance of standing in the garage and acting like you a car than coming to church and church saved you. That makes sense? Just because I stand in the garage don't make me a car, does it? Guess what? Coming to church don't make you saved. You have to spiritually be saved, and then you'll find your way into church. I get asked sometimes, why do I say this in our church services? When somebody gets saved, I want them to go to church. I don't care where that church is at, as long as it's a Jesus-based cornerstone church. I want them to just go to church somewhere, whether it's here or somewhere else. Yeah, I'd like to see them here, but I don't. Wherever they go, they need to be getting fed and grow. That's what it's all about. That's what it means to talk about building the kingdom of God. I got several notes that I'm going to stick to, and then we're going to get in a message. Now get this. If Jesus was come back today, are you ready? Are you ready to meet Jesus? Are you 100% sure you're ready to meet Jesus? See, this past week when I studied, and it started last week, you know what? There's a bunch of different classes of people, types of people in the Bible, but it all kind of sums up to three. This is what the Lord was showing me. The lost, the saved. But there's one group that the Lord says stay away from. Now, he wants us to go to the sinners, but he wants us to stay away from this one type of person. He basically kind of warns us. So we're going to see about that here in just a second. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, just thank you this day. Just thank you for who you are, and just thank you for loving us, dear Father God. Just want to thank you for the people here. Just thank you for what they do. And we just want to lift you up this morning, dear Father God. We just love you and we thank you. And just open our hearts and minds to what you want us to do. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Somebody will turn your Bibles to Matthew 7:14. And I'm going to ask you to read that, please. Matthew 7:14.
Because straight is the gate, narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there find it.
Okay. Narrow is the way. Ain't that what God just said? And how many find it? A few. A few. Now read verse 13, Brother Billy.
Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat.
Okay, so the way to destruction is how big? And how many is going?
Many.
It's a few that make it. Have you ever stopped and wondered? You know, I know we say we saved and this and that. Are you sure you're on that straight, narrow gateway? See, once you realize, hey, I know I got this thing figured out. I don't want you to lean on your own way of understanding. Because that's the reason why people get into trouble. See, I've talked to people who've done some horrendous things. They don't think they did wrong. See, there are some people that lie after lie after lie. And they don't think they lie. Y'all follow me? That's like somebody commits adultery on their wife. Guess what? That's wrong. But a lot of people don't think it was wrong because they got an excuse for doing it, right? They don't make it right. It's wrong. So once we're 100% sure that we're a child of God, got it all going on, then we got all what we want to rejoice in everything that we go through. So I had something happen to me Thursday, Friday night. It was a little bit misunderstanding, but it really, really upset me. And I've been it. Got a call. It all got worked out, but I still was upset about that because of the way I thought about that. And at that time, the way I thought about what happened was wrong. But then, after conversations, I realized that I was wrong about how I handled that. See, that's how the Holy Spirit works on us when we're yielded to Him. When you walk in the flesh, I got news for you. Listen to me right now. You're fooling yourself if you're walking in the flesh, thinking you're doing what God wants you to do. You think God's directing your steps and lighting up your path. You are foolish. Only when we yielded to God and the Holy Spirit can God use us and change us. You know what? There's people in the church, maybe not just this church, but there's people in the church that do not change. That's who God says stay away from. You say, I can't believe you're saying this. Well, we'll take a set of scripture. So if you will, turn to 2 Timothy chapter 3. See, we live in a time today where it's like, everybody come, everybody do this, everybody do that, love everybody, love this, do that. And you know, yeah, that's true, you know. For judging, we're not supposed to judge people, but there's a thing in the Bible called righteous judgment. We are supposed to use righteous judgment. But so many times we look at things in a judgmental way. And when we look at God's word, He puts it pretty clear for us how it's to be. So when we look at 2 Timothy chapter 3, it says, difficult times for Christian service. We all know what difficult means. That means it's going to be tough. It's going to be a struggle. It's going to be rough. And guess what? Satan will push you and press you to make you feel like not doing what God's called you to do. I see too many people dropping out. You know, it's really alarming how many people's quit being a pastor, quit preaching, or doing whatever just because of the pressure. Teenagers get peer pressure to do the wrong things. Why do you think they end up in the wrong places? There's a lot of churchy kids that goes to church, and when they get up in high school, guess what? They're drug away. It's going to be difficult. It says, but mark this. What's that mean? Mark this. It means write it down. You know, I'll tell Michelle sometime, hey, I'll write it down on a notebook, and I guarantee we'll be talking about something that's going to happen next week. And I'll say, I'll write it down on a notebook, and you'll see it'll be just like that. So he says, mark it down. It's going to happen. It's going to happen. And it is happening. It says, there will be terrible times in the last days. In some of your Bibles, it's going to say perilous times in the last days. Anybody got that? Perilous times? All right, what does perilous mean? It means dangerous, insecure, destructive, and toxic. Folks, we're living in that time. We're living in that time. It says here, people will be lovers of themselves. What's a narcissist? They love themselves. It's all about self. It's all, they try to hide it real good and make themselves real good. But it's very easy to see a narcissistic type person. Lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to the parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love. Y'all have heard me say this before. I've never seen a time in my life where their love is so cold. You hear it all the time. I love you. I love you. I love you. You know what? Love's useless without action behind it. We got to put action. We talk about building the church. Guess what, Chris? And if you love people, put some action behind it. Just don't sit there and say we're going to pray for them. Put some action to it. That's what's going to bring people to the kingdom of God, not church, not coming to this building. They'll see love here, but guess what? We got to go be an example of that love to people. Guess what? I've seen people go do great things for people. Ain't a whole lot of love there. They frustrated, they chaos, they get upset. They really don't. They have no joy in doing what they're doing. People see joy. People feel it. Unforgiving. See, there's been an issue that happened years and years ago. Me and Michelle was talking last night, and she said, sometimes you're not unforgiving. And I was just like, what? What do you mean? She says, you bring something up all the time. Well, I got to think about that, and I was like, you know what? If I am going to forgive it, I just need to not ever bring that up again. That's what being forgiving is all about. Unforgiveness will eat you up. I've heard Christian people talk about how they can't stand people, a certain brother or sister in Christ. I'll be honest with you. I'm still kind of like Peter. You know, when he cut the dude's ear off, sometimes you feel like smacking somebody for what they say. I'm just being serious. You know, I found out two things in life. Listen up, all you young people. There's two ways to learn a lesson you'll never forget. It's either going to cost you a lot of money or you're going to go through some pain. Either one of them is going to stick with you. It takes a lot, like a hot stove. Don't touch it. It will burn because you feel pain from that burn. Don't we'll be touching it all the time. Slanderous. Without self-control. Brutal. Not lovers of good. Treacherous. Rash. Conceited. Love of our pleasures rather than lovers of God. See, we got some people in Church House chase after their pleasures more than they do God. They give God the leftovers, the breadcrumbs, the last minute stuff. They put God's stuff off till they just have to. That ain't putting God first. Now get this, verse 5. Having a form of godliness but denying its power, have nothing to do with them. Did you just hear that? Having a form of godliness, but have nothing to do with them. You know what? Here's the sinners. Here's the saved people. Jesus wants God's people to go to the savers, to the lost, to introduce them to Jesus. But he tells us right there, hey, we're not having nothing to do with those type. What's those type of people he's talking about? Do we even know what type of people they're talking about? That he knows who we're describing right here when he says that? You know, I know this. I ain't going to get too close to a rattlesnake. I seen something funny the other day. Guess what? It's two kids, I think, in Argentina found these two stray cats. Well, they brought them home. As the cats got bigger, turned out they was pumas. Like a cougar. Better stay away from pumas. Especially two of them in your house. She realized that real quick. She called somebody to come get them. Get this. They are the kind who worm their way into homes and gain control over weak-willed women who are loaded down with sins and are swayed by all kinds of evil desires. Always learning, but never able to acknowledge the truth. I'm going to tell you something. You can study that Bible through and through, be the best preacher, best teacher, but you could be lost as last year's golden Easter egg, because guess what? The Holy Spirit's not in there to change you. If you're not changing, you're dying. And if you say you've been saved and you're not spiritually changing the way you treat people, how you act, what you say, your study habits, your prayer habits, you better look and make sure that shoe don't fit. That make sense? It says here, just as James and Jabez opposed Moses, so also these men oppose the truth, men of depraved minds. Who as far as the faith is concerned are rejected, but they will not get very far because as in the case of those men, their folly will be clear to everyone. God's going to bring it out. You're going to see it. How do you see it? Through how they act in certain situations. How they really love people. How they really treat people. Anybody can put on a front. Give you a case in point. I've seen dudes that's never rode a Harley-Davidson in their life go buy everything with a vest, put patches all over, come up to a one center game. I got news for you. They're messing with their life. They ain't who they're trying to act like they are. And those bikers will look right through that, and they might be a high price to pay. There's a thing in the Bible called true conversion and false conversion. False conversion, hey, you ain't counted the cost to follow Jesus. You ain't studied what it really takes. You just wanted to save your butt from hell. And guess what? You made this cheap turnover thing, and nothing ever happened on the inside. And I'm going to tell you something right now, Kristen. If the Holy Spirit's dead in you, and you are a true Savior, a true believer in Jesus Christ and what He done, then you need to repent and turn away from your sins and get that Holy Spirit fired up in your chest. Because these perilous times we're living in today. You follow me? How many of you dudes ever shot a deer and field dressed it, cut it up and all that? You mean to sharpen it, but you forget about it. Next time you go to do the same thing to a deer and it's dull as crap and you got to take the time to sharpen it. Hey, we got to keep it on knife sharp every day, Christian. I'm just telling you. I'm just telling you right now, you need to keep it sharp. You don't need to get offended when somebody corrects you. You don't. If you do, I will put it this way. If you're so soft that you get your feelings hurt when you are corrected, you might be this person. Because they don't like being corrected. Their way is the right way. They always want it their way. It ain't about God's way. So when we sit here and look at this a little further, it says the form or appearance of godliness includes going to church. Does that sound like something we just went over? Knowing Christian doctrine. Using Christian cliches or quotes. And following a community's Christian traditions. Such practices can make a person look good. Let me stop right there just a second. All right, let's look. Let's say you go to church somewhere. You see a dude, he preaches, he teaches, he prays and all that. You realize how many times probably said that dude's a godly man, he's ain't nothing but a snake in the grass sitting the devil himself to that church. I've seen a couple. See, I might appear one way, but I got news where I watch people's actions before I do what they say. Our actions says everything about us who we need to be. Y'all have heard me say, devil's in the house every morning. And I'll keep saying that the day I die. You know the reason why I say that? Because the Bible says so. So we can have a form of godliness, but still be lost. We can have a form of religion and still be lost. Why? How does it work? Can you see where church don't save, reading the Bible don't save, prayer don't save? Only Jesus saves. It takes the whole heart, mind, body, and soul to say, I believe in what Jesus did on that cross. I'm a sinner, and without him, I'm going to a damnation in hell, and I need him to save me from that. That's admitting that I'm a sinner, believing in what he did on that cross, and confessing it with my mouth. I have no problem telling who my Lord and Savior is, and he is my Lord. He is my King. I am his servant. I am to please him. I don't think about my way or the highway. Too many in a church house is all about themselves, chasing the world, and you can't hide it. To those who's filled with the Spirit, I'm just telling you. Just telling you. Well, why are you preaching like this way, Brother Gary? I'm telling you, I'd rather upset you than see you go to hell. Love you that much. See, we don't do the hard love things anymore, do we? Very few. Back in my childhood, guess what? One of the hard kind of loves, kind of like spare rods full of child. Hey, you got strapped with that switch out there on that going up. I told the story about that tree over there. I ain't ever cut it, but that's what my mom used to swat us boys with. My dad put a 20-pound sledgehammer in your hand at 10, 12 years old. He didn't care how long you swung it, but you was going to swing it till he said swing it. He didn't care about your blisters on your hand. You got, guess what? He could throw you a pair of gloves and you kept going. Today, if you did that, you're going to be locked up in jail. Locked up in jail. I know one case, where a 17-year-old boy called his mom the B word. She smacked him. He went and called the law. They come and carried her to jail. Truth. So I'd rather deal out some tough love this morning than pat you on the wrist and let you continue down that path. And guess what? It could be somebody listening. I ain't saying it's anybody here. It could be somebody's listening. I'm just preaching what God told me to preach this morning because somebody needed to hear what I'm saying this morning. You know what? You're playing with your soul. You're playing with your soul. You can't fake the Holy Spirit. Think about how foolish the devil is. The devil thought he was going to be bigger than God in heaven. That didn't work. What happened to him? He got cast down, and a third of the angels went with him, and people don't want to hear this kind of preaching, but guess what? A third of the demons come with him, and they are all over the earth today filling up people. They waiting for a place to jump in. They waiting for a place to live. They want to put up house. But their day's coming. It's fixing the end. That's part of the perilous times we're living in. And guess what? There's things happening all over this world right now that lines up with the Bible, and it's mind-blowing if you know what to look for. But guess what? I do not let that get me down. You know, a lot of times people come up and say, well, you know what, Brother Gary's struggling about something. No, I ain't struggling about something. You know what? I'm concerned about some people. I'm concerned about what's going on. I love my country. I love my children. I would love to see my granddaughter grow up the way I grew up, but that ain't ever going to happen either. And what I'm trying to say is better wake up, Christian, because you're going to be part to blame for it, sitting back not doing nothing. You know what? It's not the evil that's really bad. It's the people sitting back watching evil take place and not doing nothing. And you know what's really crazy, church? You know what Albert Einstein said? He said to keep doing the same things over and over and over is insanity. Church, you got to quit doing the same things over and over and over. But get this, but your inner attitude of belief, love, and worship are lacking, the outer appearance is meaningless. See, it's all about the inner man. It's all about the inner man. It's how you treat people. It's how you act. It's what you say. Guess what? I'm going to tell you something, Christian, right now. You know what? We've been doing worship music the way we've been doing worship music. You know why? When it comes down to it, it's your inner soul that's going to bring worship and praise to this church house. We ain't going to do light shows. I ain't putting up no smoke screens. I ain't putting up an LED show. It ain't happening. It will not happen. I'll wait for God's people to start singing and shouting and praising Him the way it needs to be, or it won't happen. Because that's the way it's supposed to be. That's the way it's supposed to be. Amazing thing about this, to show you how God's been working amongst other people. This week, two or three times, it's been coming up to me because I think it started one time and I said something, I don't know. But it started, I think, with David Platt. He said, you know, you come in and take all the cushy seats out. You turn the AC air off. He said, you take the carpets out. You take the frappe and the coke machines out. I'm going to tell you something, church. I don't agree with that stuff, by the way. I'm just telling you. We don't sell merchandise in God's house. But you take all that away, how many people here today is going to come just hear God's word read? Very few. Very few. You know where they're going to run? They're going to run to the frappes and the big cushy seats and the AC and all this other stuff. I'm just telling you. You can get upset at me the way you want to. But that's how I feel about it. That's what the Lord's put in my heart to say. We come together to read God's word, to get band-aids on what we need band-aids. We get hugs where we need to be hugs. And we get ammunition to go out and fight the devil. It's a spiritual battle. That's the perilous times we're living in. And if we can't see that, I don't know what to tell you. I don't know what to tell you. I got news for you. I got news for you. If men in America, you know, all men want to walk around all puffed up, this and that. You couldn't have lived 160 years ago. There's a few I know that could survive. But you know what? If what's going on in America right now would have happened, it kind of did. Remember the Boston Tea Party? The revolution. I ain't saying start a war, but if men of God would stand up for God, this country would change. Yeah. It might not stop the timeline, but here's the thing. I'm not giving in to that, and I want God to slap me, give me a high five, hug me, or look and say, hey, you did what I told you to do. You fought the good fight. That's what I want to hear. It's His battle. He's already won the war, and we've got to win our fight. But guess what? This type of person ain't even going to heaven because he's never changed. Now somebody turn to Galatians 5:22. And while you're turning, I'm going to finish reading this. Paul warns us not to be deceived by people who only appear to be Christian. It may be difficult to distinguish them from true Christians at first, but their daily behavior will give them away. It says the characteristics described in chapter 3, verses 2 through 4 are unmistakable. So the description, the characteristics of this person is in verses 2 through 4. You might go, well, I got a couple of them. I ain't got all of them. Oh, I'm good. No, if you got one of them. Need to look at that. So what does Galatians 5:22 say?
But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, and faith.
Huh. You know the reason I called my wife up here this morning? She got a lot of characteristics I ain't got yet. I see that, and I want that. But it takes me saying, Lord, I give that up. I want that. Then it'll start working on it. But see, here's the key to it. Once it's been revealed to you, then it's up to you to put it at the foot of that cross and say, change me. That's when it starts happening. If you're here today, I want you to leave here 100% sure that you're going to heaven. I want you to rejoice in that when you walk out those doors, when you hit that street. Don't let bad times and the devil rain on your parade. Punch that dude in the mouth and said, I'm a child of the one true God. Get away from me. And when you resist the devil, he will flee from you. But if you want to hug the devil's neck, guess what? You're going to hug the devil's neck, and you're going to have a hard time getting rid of it. You know the reason people stay in the slop hole all the time? Because they're holding hands with the devil and claiming to be a Christian. Guess what? Get away from that. But here's the thing. If you're here today and you feel like that's talking about you, today is your day to change that. Today is that day to say, you know what, God? What your word says convicted me to the core of my spirit, changed me. I want Jesus in my life as Lord and Savior. And he'll take it all every bit away. And I guarantee you, when you get up, you're going to be a completely new person. You're going to have a different life. You're going to have a different walk. You're going to have a different stride about you. With every head bowed, with every eye closed. Hey, whatever your situation is today, I just want you to search for it. I want you to look for it. I want you to be that person. Be that example. You know the amazing thing about it? I'm fixing to shut up. Paul said he's the example. You know what? My example is Jesus Christ because I see and I know who Jesus is. But you know what? I know who Paul is too. Paul's an example that we can look at from a dude that was persecuting and killing Christians to hating Christianity to one of the biggest soul winners, the biggest evangelist in the New Testament. Yeah, he's an example to follow because you know what he did? His words was spoke to God on this. But you know what? He lived it. He walked it. He talked it. He's an example. But yes, we can look at Paul and say, hey, I need to kind of copy after him. We all need somebody we can look up to. We all need somebody we can call. You know the one reason why the Lord, I think, is hammering me on being that mature Christian? We got so many young Christians in the church and so many people just committing themselves. Hey, they need somebody mature to grab them by the hand and say, hey, brother, hey, sister, I'm here for you. I'll sacrifice my time for you. What you need? Sometimes we got to say, you know what? I can't go on that trip because this brother needs something. This sister needs something. You know what? Last thing I'm saying. Hey, God speaks to me and he lets me know what to do, what I need to say. Hey, it's up for you to have that same type of connection, that communication, that Holy Spirit vibe going on. It's all through the Holy Spirit. It's only through Jesus Christ we do what we do. Dear Heavenly Father, just thank you this day. Just thank you for who you are. Just thank you for loving us, dear Father God. We just want to lift you up and praise you this morning and just be who you want us to be. You know, you called each one of us to be who we are. You know, you look at John the Baptist, you know, the dude, the wild hair, woolly, the camel hair. Hey, that's who you called him to be. Then we got some you've called to dress up and be who they are. Let us just get wrapped up in who Jesus is and what he wants to do through us. Let us forget this petty stuff. Let us just grow in Christ and glorify God the Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.
All right, we've got any prayer requests today?
I got a question. Can we get Brandon the right hand fellowship after before we leave out here?
I was going to get with you first. I did talk to him and talk to brother back there about being baptized. So, folks, just kind of show you how the Lord fills my heart. We get new Christians saved in this church. They need somebody to look up to.
Yeah.
They need a godly character, a person that they can look up to and call. I tell people that. But sometimes they don't want to call a pastor, maybe. See what I'm saying? Dude, I'm just ready.
I know that, but
you know, let's give him some hugs and love when we leave, and just encourage him, and just encourage him. And I just tell you, and I told you this other day, hey, just because you get saved don't mean it's all going to be peaches and cream. Because the devil come now, you're in a fist fight. Okay? Just let you know, we got people who got your back. So if we ever need it, we're here. Okay? Love you, brother.
All right, once again, any prayer requests?
I have one. Whitney has a friend whose father really needs some lifting up in prayer right now. She didn't want me to say his name, but she asked if we would pray for him.
All right. Seen somebody over here?
Neely.
Jaybird.
Okay.